It's me. I'm Melody. I'm your daughter.
Hello, my fellow Whovians and subscribers, and welcome to my latest Doctor Who review, where today I review the Series 6 mid-series finale, I guess you could say, A Good Man Goes to War, written by Stephen Moffat and starring Matt Smith as the 11th Doctor. So, A Good Man Goes to War, this is the final story of the first half of Series 6, which would then be split, and the second half of Series 6 would air in autumn 2011. This would air... Well, this would sort of finish airing, I think it was like May or something. I can't remember the exact dates, but it started in like after Easter 2011. So we only got half the series, and then they'd split it, and then we get the other half in autumn. You get the idea. And this is the story where at long last, we discover the true identity of River Song. So anyway, the plot is as follows. On the asteroid Demon's Run, Amy Pond has given birth, but the villainous Madame Kavarian and the religious order of the Silence are waiting to make a collection that tears Amy's world apart. Across the galaxy, the Doctor and Rory are assembling an army to fight the battle that lies ahead, whilst in Stormcage, River Song prepares to escape from what may be the last time. For this is the Battle of Demon's Run. On this day, the Doctor will rise higher than ever and fall so much further. And finally, this is the day he discovers who River Song is. So, A Good Man Goes to War. It's interesting because we're almost halfway through the series, and if you've been watching my reviews since the beginning, you'll know that I've not been particularly hot on this series so far. It's been a rather cold reception, which is a real shame because, you know, it would have been nice to have felt that the build up to this story would have been worth it. Sadly, the previous episodes have been rather up and down for me. Although I have to say, A Good Man Goes to War, this is great. Hallelujah. We finally get a great story in Series 6. Bravo. I mean, it isn't perfect. I've got a couple of quibbles with it, but, you know, over the other episodes, I'll take it. I'll take this over the previous stories. This is better than all the previous Series 6 stories, and it is definitely one of the stronger stories in Series 6. And I have to give Moffat credit, actually, because I think he did a rather good job with this one. Again, it's not perfect. It doesn't always tie in. There are a few things that don't make sense, but it is much more entertaining, much more enjoyable than all of the previous stories. What I like about A Good Man Goes to War is the fact that it's epic. The epic scope of this story is amazing. They're really bigging up the stakes this time. The fact that the Doctor is assembling an army of people who we've all met before, except the Paternoster Gang, to defeat the villains and Madame Kavarian at Demon's Run. I mean, you could argue that not all of these people really need to be at Demon's Run, like the captain of the ship in Curse of the Black Spot and his son. I mean, do they really need to be in this story? I don't think so. I mean, even Dorium doesn't really need to be here. I mean, he's... I don't know why he's really in it, to be honest. But we also have characters like Dorium from Series 5. I kind of like Dorium, even though he probably doesn't need to be in it, but that's cool. The Paternoster Gang are interesting characters, and obviously down the line in Series 7, they will become more recurring characters, and I think Madame Vastra is probably the best. She's this sort of stern, sort of Silurian creature who lives in Victorian London with her maid. I think that's the right word I was looking for. Her maid Jenny, who's a very interesting character. Strax as well as a Sontaran, and he joins them in the battle. And I kind of like Strax in this one. He's kind of funny how he ends up. He's a nurse for some reason. And then he's trying to heal people, and then he's like, I hope we meet again one day, where I will destroy you for the glory of the Suntaran Empire. Some of his wisecracks are kind of funny. I like it in this story. If it becomes a problem going forward, we'll leave that till future reviews. But as of now, I think they're okay. And it actually takes the Doctor quite a long time to appear in this story. The Doctor doesn't appear until like the first 20 minutes, which I think actually builds up the anticipation. Some people would argue that it's too long before the Doctor appears, and I can understand that. But the episode is 48 minutes long, so we get plenty of screen time with Matt Smith when he finally makes his appearance. I mean, his reveal could have potentially been a bit more epic, but still, I like the way it was done when he lowered the hood and he was like, surprised. And he's obviously snuck his way in, disguised as one of the monks. I mean, just the sheer scope of this story is quite impressive. The way we get all these different aliens in the story, like even the Cybermen are in it, and the Doctor blows up an entire cyber fleet just to make a point. And you know how much he is willing to do to get to Amy and to conquer Demon's Run. We also have the Silurians; they make a brief cameo as well. And obviously, I think the Silence, they might appear once or twice, I can't remember. I have to say, I really love that opening sequence when the Doctor destroys that cyberfleet, as I've said, and Rory enters and he's like, I have a question, a message from the Doctor and a question from me, where is my wife? And then they're like, what is the Doctor's message? And then the fleet just blows up in the background and Rory's got the really stern look on his face and he's like, would you like me to repeat the question? That was badass. That was pretty awesome. I like that opening. I really like Karen Gillan's performance as well as Amy. She's really good. I mean, she doesn't get to do much in terms of any sort of action-based roles, but you know, she's the emotional center of the story because obviously she's the mother of Melody, as that's what they call the baby, Melody. Although I do have to say, it's a little bit stupid how the Doctor can speak baby because essentially babies aren't that well developed, so how can the Doctor understand everything that's going on? I know he's a Time Lord, but it's strange how Melody and the Doctor can communicate when she's only a baby, because she's not fully developed yet, so that doesn't really make sense. Matt Smith as the Doctor is really good in this one. This is one of my favourite Matt Smith performances, actually, because he's really pushed to the edge. He thinks he's gone higher, and he thinks he's won. But then there's a turning point in the story where he realises, oh shit, I think I've lost, which is really interesting. So I like the way the stakes kind of flip and kind of change. So the battle feels like the odds are very much even, and it's not like one side is really greater than the other. That's the perception of what goes on. There are a couple of things that I don't understand about this story. For one thing, how is Melody a flesh avatar? Like, that was never explained. I mean, obviously, there's more episodes to come, and maybe they'll explain it in the future of Series 6, but I can't remember in any of the future episodes if they do mention it, so I don't quite understand how Melody was a flesh. That didn't really make a huge amount of sense, because the real Amy was at Demon's Run and gave birth, so what? Like, when did they make a copy of Melody? It's a bit confusing. Also, there's this character called Lorna, who's like this soldier. She apparently encountered the Doctor when she was younger, and she had like a brief 30-second encounter, to which the Doctor somehow remembers, but we don't get any insight into this character. Apparently she helps them in the fight, and then she dies. So what was honestly the point of her character? I mean, whether it was just a way of them trying to tease the fact that she might be a grown-up version of Melody, I don't know. But if that was the reason, then that's kind of a stupid reason. I think it was kind of pointless. Her character added nothing to the story. Really, nothing. But I like the fact that Moffat, you know, went to the effort of assembling the team, and, you know, the first half of the story really is the build-up, getting people together. There's a lot of action in this story, and the battle sequences and the action is really well done, and it's a real spectacle, this story, and I think that's one of the reasons why I really enjoyed it a lot compared to the previous stories. And I also appreciated the fact that there was a little bit of diversity in the story with a gay married couple, one of them who was a little bit overweight and the other one who was thin. They're a male couple, and it's just a shame that one of them dies. It's a real shame, but I give Moffat the points for having a bit of diversity in there. That was nice. And it was in the background. And, well, that's what... If you're going to introduce those kind of things in Doctor Who, I think keeping them in the background is a good idea, not taken away from what the show actually is. Shout out to Murray Gold for the music. I love the set as well. I think the production design is amazing. And actually, the CGI has actually held up quite well for a TV budget. You know, Demon's Run looks amazing, and some of the shots look just incredible. You know, it does look very cinematic, which is what I do appreciate about this story. It is pretty huge. It is pretty epic. And of course, I have to talk about the ending of the story, in which Alex Kingston as River Song turns up. she knows when to turn up again, because her and the Doctor keep meeting out of order. And she reveals to Amy and Rory that she is in fact Melody, their daughter. At the time, I remember thinking, wow, this is a great twist. This is an interesting thing. I'm interested to see where it's going to go. And whilst I do still think it's a great twist, I think actually, okay, that was quite well done. I like the idea. It's not as clever as Moffat thinks it is. He hasn't interwoven the series that well so far, so a lot of things are still confusing. Like the idea of Melody, well, she is human, but the idea of the fact that she can regenerate, that she has some kind of Time Lord DNA, and the conversation about Melody's conception, or River's conception, I should say, it's just really awkward. And that scene with Matt Smith talking to Madame Master about when Amy and Rory did it on the TARDIS, and the fact that it was done on the TARDIS means that River has some kind of Time Lord energy inside her, some Time Lord DNA. It's really confusing. It's just, they're trying to be discreet about it, but really, it doesn't make a huge amount of sense why she can do the things she can do, and this will become even more apparent in the next story. Let's kill Hitler. But, you know, for what it's worth, I kind of like the twist. And the fact that we saw the Doctor's cot was a nice thing there. The fact that he still had his own cot in the TARDIS, I thought that was a nice little callback. And, you know, interesting. We've never sort of delved into the idea of the Doctor being a baby, you know, ever. We've never had anything from the Doctor's childhood appear in the show, as far as I know. So that was a nice callback. And yeah, that's A Good Man Goes to War. It's overall very good. It's very, very good. And it's definitely an improvement over the previous stories. But it's not perfect. I can't give it a perfect score. So I will finish up by giving A Good Man Goes to War a 9 out of 10. So, that brings me to the end of my review of A Good Man Goes to War. What do you think of this story? Please comment down below, let me know. And stay tuned next time, folks, for my very first extreme, epic, major, fucking rant of the new series of Doctor Who. Let's kill Hitler. Or let's kill Series 6 of Doctor Who. So that's going to be a fun one to put out there. Oh, it's not going to be fun to watch, but it will be fun for you guys to see my reaction to it anyway. So until then, thank you all for watching, and as always, I'm Mr. TARDIS 11. See ya. Bye for now.